Did you know there are four different ways to pass function parameters in C++? First, pass by value. This is the simplest way. At the calling site, you can pass both variables and temporaries normally. In the function declaration, you just specify the variable type and the variable name. The function can read the contents of this variable, but it can also make changes into it. Making changes will not modify the original variable. This works by making a copy of the variable when it is passed as a parameter. This is good for simple variables like number constants, pointers, and simple structures like std string view and sometimes std pair. However, if you try to pass a complex object as the parameter, say a phone book, this is what happens.
Oh, you want to borrow my math textbook? Hold on, let me make a copy of it. Here you go, you can do anything you want with this copy, I don't need it anymore.
And this can be quite bad for the program's performance. Duplicating a phone book can take a long time. The ubiquitous method of parameter passing in C++, especially for non-trivial objects such as containers, is the const reference. At the calling site, you can pass both named variables and also temporaries to the function in exactly the same way you would do when passing by value. Inside the function, you can only access const methods of the object, but not non-const methods. In other words, you can read, but you cannot write. The const reference is a promise you make to the caller that you will not tamper with their object in any manner. In exchange to the promise, the caller lets you use their actual object without making a special copy of it for you. It leads into very efficient code. Here is a little video clip illustrating this const promise contract.
Oh, you want to borrow my MacBook Pro? Sure, just give it back as it is.
Thanks, I'll take great care of it. Hey, thanks for the loan, here it is.
Anytime.
Now, what happens if you use constcast inside the function to actually make changes to the object?
Thanks, I'll take great care of it. Here you go, thanks for the loan.
What is the meaning of this? This is not what I gave you. You've betrayed my trust. It's treason then.
So the bottom line is, the const reference leads into very high performance natural code, but it carries with it the promise and trust that the function will not make any changes into the object. If you need to make modifications to the object inside the function, there is an easy solution. Just remove the const keyword. Now the function can both read and write to the object. At the calling side, things have changed a bit. If you have got a named variable, you can pass this to the function without problems as long as this variable is not const. The function might make modifications to the variable, so when it returns, your variable has been modified. However, if you have got a temporary, it is impossible to pass this to the function without assigning it into a named variable first. Well, there is a way through a series of casts, but this is ugly code which you should never do. The purpose of a non-const reference is usually that you explicitly request the function to make some particular modification to your object. Here is a video illustration how this works.
Here's my stapler. I would like you to change its color, please.
Sure, it'll only take 5 microseconds.
Thank you.
The fourth type is called a R-value reference. It looks similar to the L-value reference, except that instead of 1 ampersand, you put 2 ampersands. Let's study the calling site first. If you have got a temporary object, you can pass them to the function that expects an R-value reference, just like you would do if it was a by-value or a const reference. It will work perfectly fine. However, if you have a named object in a variable, this will no longer work. To pass the named object as a R-value reference, you need to add a stdmove into the call. The only thing that stdmove does is it adds a cast into an R-value reference. Essentially, it tells the compiler and the person reading your source code of your intention. See, the purpose of R-value references is to pass ownership of data. You use R-value references when you no longer need the contents of the object and you want to move or pass forward it to a function. Essentially, you are saying,
I don't need this anymore. You can have it. do what you want with it.
Inside the function, you can both read and write the object. When you use R-value references, I find it to be a recommendable practice to always clear the object before returning, unless you already explicitly transferred the content ownership to another function or object before returning. This enforces the principle that whenever you use stdmove, you can trust that the next time you access the object, it is blank state as if it was just default constructed. So, in summary, these four methods all have their own merits, which make them usable in different situations. Rather than try to explain in words things that you can already see on the screen, let's turn this information into a nice flowchart. When deciding which mechanism to use, start by asking yourself, is the purpose of the function to modify variables provided by the caller? If the answer is yes, what kind of modifications it is supposed to do? If they are modifications that will be beneficial for the caller, use the traditional L-value reference. But if they are modifications that rob the value of its content, such as by transferring the ownership of the data to some other object, then use the R-value reference denoted by the double ampersand. If the purpose of the function is not to modify the caller's data, we still have a few more cases to go. Does the function still need to make modifications to those variables that it receives? If it does not, there are two options. If the variable is lightweight, such as integers or character pointers, just pass the value by value. If the data is heavy, like a phone directory, then use the const reference. If the function needs to make modifications to the data, study the role of the function. Is it part of some kind of interface? Will it be called by code that you have not yet written? Will the function declaration be read by someone who wants to understand what the function does? If so, use const reference and make a temporary copy inside the function for editing. Otherwise, your function is probably a helper function of some kind, and it is only ever called once and the call is in the same source code file. In that case, two cases remain. How is it called? Does the caller still need the original value after the call? If so, pass the variable by value. Otherwise, use the R-value reference and stdmove if necessary. Now, to be fair, there are a few other ways to pass data. You can use pointers like in C. The pointers can be const or non-const. Pointers are like references, except more cumbersome and come with limitations. Pointers are what you must use in C if you need to modify the original value, but they are pretty much deprecated in C++ unless you have a very, very good reason to use them. Or you can use a functor. What the functors do and how they deal with data is totally up to you, and it is not possible to make any generalizations of them in this table. However, functors usually require adding a template parameter, which can be undesirable for a number of reasons. There is also the const R-value reference, which is used for deleting R-value reference overloads. If you don't know what it means, chances are you will not need it. So, the next time you create a function, think carefully. Reflect on the purpose of the function, purpose of each parameter. Hopefully, this video helps you choosing the right parameter passing style for each parameter. Thank you all the listed contributors for the video clips used in this video. Thank you all my old and new supporters at Patreon and PayPal. Without you, it would be much more difficult for me to make these videos. Nowadays, you can also join my channel on YouTube if you don't like using Patreon but still like to support me financially. Hello to all my old and new subscribers. It looks like the milestone of 100,000 subscribers is approaching much sooner than I had anticipated. I was thinking like years, and now it looks like a couple of weeks at most. I can hardly even fathom the significance of that number. It was only like yesterday that I only had 2,000. Okay, actually it was 6.5 years, but time goes so fast these days. What is your favorite content on my channel? Leave a comment on this page and share your thoughts. See you again and have a very nice day.